Hello and good morning again. I'm happy to announce that we have actually reached the target of 500 subscribers in the Interventionist channel. So this is a tribute to you all who had made this happen. I have decided to discuss upon a short topic on MRI fistulogram. Thank the organizers of the CREST, namely Dr. Rijo and my moderator, Dr. Vinod Sukumaran, and all other participants who were there in that meeting. This had happened only because of the support from my YouTube subscribers, and I am grateful and thankful to you. Thank you. So we'll just briefly describe about MRI fistulogram, basic anatomy, and we'll go on discussing about the basic anatomy and how do we plan for an MR fistulogram, and the widely used classification systems, and we'll discuss some cases as well. So there was other than MRI fistulogram, we have other modalities to evaluate a fistula, namely X-ray and CT fistulogram, and you can even use ultrasound also. So the problem with X-ray fistulogram and CT fistulogram is the resolution, lack of resolution. The main problem is the lack of resolution, and there is a very different, very minimal, little or no distinction between the adjacent structures. And it is very difficult to track the plane if it is intersphincteric. So that is one reason. And then in USC, it has a good local resolution. You can clearly see the different sphincters in intersphincteric spaces and the ischiorectal region and all. But the problem is the FOV is quite limited to maybe axially it is only limited to some less than maybe 2 to 3 centimeters from the probe's direction, any direction. And you need a good amount of training to do an endorectal ultrasound and find out the findings. So that's the thing. Then why MRI? The reason is quite plain and simple, because you are evaluating the patient in the anatomy which we all are familiar with, and it's very highly useful in differentiating muscle, fat, bone, and any other extra pathologic structures in that area. So that is the reason why MRI has become the gold standard. So take my word, MRI is currently the gold standard in evaluating fistulas everywhere. So, and it also has the advantage of a non-invasive technique, because we are not injecting anything into the track as such. We'll only be just marking the external opening and we'll be doing the study. So that is one advantage. So this is actually taken from one of the journals published in Radiographics on 2012. So imaging of perianal fistula, the main importance of the imaging is that it can demonstrate hidden areas of sepsis and secondary extensions, both which are actually the cause for recurrence after surgery. And also MR imaging can predict the likelihood of having a post-operative fecal incontinence, which we will discuss how it happens. So briefly on the anatomy part, I know everybody will be familiar with anatomy. So two landmarks, one is anatomical anal canal and the surgical anal canal. So anatomical anal canal actually extends from the anal verge till the where you call the dentate line, which is seen here. This is the anal canal till the dentate line. Surgical anal canal, where we measure it from the anal canal and anal verge till the anorectal junction, little bit superiorly. So then we have the sphincters. We have namely two sphincters, internal sphincter and the external sphincter. So the internal sphincter, what does it imply? Is internal sphincter is actually an extension of the smooth muscles of the rectum itself. And the external sphincter is actually a continuation, or it will continue into the levator ani muscle. And the difference between these two muscles is the internal sphincter is a smooth muscle, and that is involuntary muscle. And the external sphincter is a striated muscle, which is a voluntary muscle. So external sphincter, there are three parts. When you may describe it from the skin deeper, superficial, or no, subcutaneous, superficial, deep. And then we have the puborectalis, which is at the area which also perform a part of the external sphincter complex. So, and then it continues as levator rhinae. So whenever I report a case, I always mention the in the reports that there is internal sphincter and about the external sphincter complex. Either I will mention external sphincter separately with in relationship with the puborectalis muscle and levator rhinae, or I'll mention it as external sphincter complex. So depending upon the complexity of the track, you can give the report like that. Okay. So moving ahead. So I've already mentioned that about incontinence. So how it happens is, internal sphincter, even though it maintains the tone, anal tone, it does not have any voluntary role. Like you can't voluntarily control the internal sphincter. Meanwhile, the external sphincter is the sphincter which allows you to hold on without passing feces. So the external sphincter is the main sphincter which controls the defecation. So remember this: if you are if there is a tract involving the external sphincter, there is a chance that postoperatively the patient can develop fecal incontinence. So remember that. Okay. So internal sphincter contracts involuntarily and is responsible for 85% of the resting tone of the anal canal. While meanwhile, the external sphincter only contributes to 15%, but its voluntary contractions will prevent defecation. So if you unnecessarily divide the external sphincter, it might result in fecal incontinence in postoperative period. So you should be clearly mentioning what is happening, which all sphincters are affected. So those things has to be clear in your report. So coming to male and female pelvis. So in the male pelvis, what happens is that the external sphincter actually merges anteriorly. It is like a closed thing in male pelvis. But in female pelvis, the external sphincter tends to laterally deviate, and it will be almost touching the pubic bones like this, so that it can accommodate the urethra and vagina. So as you can all guess that more complexity of intersphincteric tract fistulas are commonly seen in females if present. So I'll just show you in how it appears in T2. This is a T2 axial T2 weighted image, non-fat suppressed T2 axial weighted image. So you can see here the black thing actually represents the external sphincter. The actual the wall of the rectum, anal canal, represents the internal sphincter, and the intermediate signal in between the external and internal sphincter represents the intersphincteric space. So this is something what you call as an anal clock. So what do you do? The anal clock is the thing which you use to describe the anal clock properly. So what you know is you will be reporting the internal openings, the tract positions, and the external opening based upon the clock position like this. So anteriorly it is 12 o'clock, posteriorly it is natal cleft. So there has been studies which they have conducted patients in prone position. Even in prone position, remember this, anterior will always be considered as pubic symphysis and posterior will be always considered as natal cleft. This is you have to follow. Even if you are doing in a prone or supine position, remember this so that you won't get confused with the clock position. So we ideally do our studies in supine position, and we have a good outcome of that. Okay, this is a female pelvis. As I suggested earlier, the dark line which extends laterally is the external sphincter. This internal sphincter is the same that corresponds to the outer part of the wall of anal canal. And you can see in between the internal and external sphincter, there is lot of soft tissue which has fat signal in the intersphincteric space. So the intersphincteric space of female pelvis is more compared to male. So briefly about etiopathogenesis. As a radiologist, we have to know this, because most of the tracts arises from the recurrence or persistent infection of the anal glands, which is usually located in and around the dentate line. And the thing is that this always gives rise to, if there is an infection in the dentate line, usually the tract will get obstructed and the duct will get obstructed, and there will be a collection initially, and this collection will try to drain out either through an intersphincteric path or a transphincteric path. So the easiest way is intersphincteric path. So if there is an intersphincteric collection with not much complexity, usually the drainage will be through the intersphincteric plane itself. So collection it will be transsphincteric path, and external opening will also be there, and there will be an internal opening can also be present. Sometimes there can be no external openings, or there will not be any internal opening into the anal canal cavity. Okay, so there is this interesting law called Goodsell's law. It has very less relevance in modern day because we are clearly seeing the tracks in MRI. So this was actually used by surgeons to predict the complexity or possibility of a track and its internal opening. What basically it says is that you consider the anal canal as a circle and you divide it into two halves, anterior and posterior halves. So the anterior half, wherever there is an internal opening in the anterior half, the possible external opening will also be around the anterior part of the transverse anal line, and the tracks tend to be more linear in nature. Meanwhile, posterior tracks are appear to be more complex in nature. This is a law definition, but it is not always true. And there is an application for this in MR as well. In an event where you don't see a external opening, or you are unable to see an external opening in an anterior internal opening track, or vice versa, where you are not able to see an internal opening in an anteriorly opening external track, you can always search for an opening in the anterior half, similarly in that of the posterior half. So this is the application currently for radiologists. So imaging. So imaging wise, we use all standard sequences, but only thing is the plane of imaging is different for coronal as well as axial. Sagittal is acquired as same as elsewhere imaging of pelvis. So sagittal T2 weighted images, we use fast spin echo sequences, or you can we use FS also, fast fat suppression also. So axial and coronal images are acquired in oblique planes. So I will show you the plane how it is acquired. So this is actually a T2 sagittal image which we use for planning. We first acquire T2 sagittal images, then we use the same for planning in other sequences. Okay, so what we have here is, this is the coronal plane. So you can see I have marked an orange line here. This is actually the axis of rectum and anorectal junction. So upon this axis, if you want to acquire a true oblique axial images, you have to acquire perpendicular sections like this. The planning should be perpendicular. Meanwhile, in coronal sections, the planning should be parallel to the orange line, that is parallel to the axis of anorectal junction. So this varies in different patients. So you have to make sure that you have included it in the correct plane. So the clock positions and the internal openings and the anatomic structures are very clearly delineated. So that is one important take home point. Additional to this, you may do 3D two protocols, which we do routinely. I will show you an interesting case where you can understand why it is important. So you can also do diffusion weighted images with ADC to identify acute abscesses, and STIR or T2FS images of oblique axial or sagittal is good for comparative study. And always mark external openings using a silicon capsule or a water capsule, and whatever is available with you. And try not to insert anything into the anal canal because it is painful for the patient most of the time. So whenever we practice, our technicians will answer whether contrast is needed or not. So for me, what I feel is, if it is a simple fistula, that is a grade 1 intersphincteric type according to St. James criteria, St. James Hospital criteria, where there is no additional tracks or nothing seen in the plane images, and the adjacent fat, that is the issue anal fat or issue rectal fat, shows uniform suppression on FS images. Also, the pelvic fat should also be showing uniform suppression in FS images. There is no need to do a post-contrast study in that particular case. And of course, there might be other contraindications also to do a contrast study. Then you can withdraw contrast study, because most of the 3D sequences, like T2 3D sequence, which we use in our department, where we use turbo spin echo sequence to visualize the 3D alignment of the track, it's very easy to pick up all the additional tracks and even the internal openings quite easily. So there is no need to do a post contrast in such scenario. But remember this, if the patient is going for a non-surgical management and he has presented to you with an acute event, then post contrast study has its role, because enhancement of wall is seen in acute phase. If the therapy is worked, then the patient has, even if the, some discharge might be there, the wall enhancement will decrease in post contrast study if the surgery is not done and is on medical management. But remember this, whenever there are complex tracts or a secondary small collections, there is, it is ideal to do a post contrast evaluation if unless otherwise other contraindications are there. So dynamic contrast enhancement study can be useful in detecting underlying conditions which may cause recurrence in post therapy. This has been taken from an article in, published in Radiology. So they have the study was exclusively for Crohn's disease, but it is also applicable for conditions like malignancies. And another application is that you can do 3D images and T1 weighted FS sequences using gradient echo sequences, and you can do a subtraction study of MR crystallography. So you can get the like a track alone picture. So it will also give a good idea about the 3D resolution, but nowadays it is not practiced worldwide because of the advance in normal conventional protocols like T2, T1 and all are quite good when you compare it for our last decade. So then we comes to classification of fistula. Park's classification was one of the widest used classification prior to St. James University Hospital classification. The problem with Park's is they only took consideration of the primary track. They never took consideration of the secondary track. So St. James University Hospital classification took consideration of both the primary and secondary tracks, and they have incorporated the anatomic MR findings in axial and coronal planes into the classification. So PARCS is basically a surgeon's classification. St. James is actually a radiologist classification. So we tend to follow St. James classification. So we'll just describe the types on an image. So this is actually a PARCS classification. So what happens is that, please ignore the markings. These are the markings I will explain later. So type A of PARCS is actually a simple linear intersphincteric tract fistula with no collections. Type B is actually a transsphincteric tract. Type C is an actually suprasphincteric tract like this. And type D is an extrasphincteric tract which does not involve the sphincters. So in this is the PARCS classification. Now into when you come into St. James University classification, grade 1 fistula is actually a simple linear track in the intersphincteric plane. And when you have a collection, it becomes grade 2. Meanwhile, grade 3 is a simple track of simple transsphincteric track without no collections. But whenever collection or additional track is there, it will become complex and it is reported as grade 4. Now, the last two one are the extrasphincteric and the suprasphincteric types, which is classified as supralevator and translevator extension. So supralevator extension basically we will consider when there is an intrapelvic pathology, that is inside the pelvis above the levator. So somewhat it almost resembles the PARCS classification, but it addresses the all the secondary collections and classifications also. So always there is a dilemma when you have a twin tracks. Like you have a collection in the intersphincteric space and you have a draining point like this, and you have a collection in the extrasphincteric space, that is in the ischiorectal fossa, which does not drain outside like this, but the drainage is through intersphincteric plane. So what you do classify? You have to classify it as a complex fistula because in the involvement of in transsphincteric space, that is it is crossing the external sphincter. This is the end of this current session, and we will discuss upon other cases on the next part, that is part 2 video, which will finish the MR fistula completely. So thank you, do continue watching, do subscribe and share, and also follow us on Instagram handle. Please check the description below. Thank you.